I was just taking a look at the article on the Pope and what he said today, and reading the comments, and I have good news for everybody. We are not stuck in the mindset that generates all this confusion. We are absolutely not stuck there. So even though it's appalling to read these comments, there was like one comment, all of them, that even was close to having any understanding. We're not stuck. We are not stuck at all. And that's the reassurance here that helps us. It's so helpful to have examples of the mind, spirit, not being stuck in madness. And then we realize, hey, I can do that too. Yeah, I don't have to be stuck either. We're not really stuck. It's just we're so completely accustomed, like a fish in water, to this confusion and lack of perspective and lack of context that we just assume, oh, that's what we're supposed to be doing here. It is not what we're supposed to be doing here. But it's very hard to swim against the current. So, you know, the statements, the world is just upside down and backwards and so absolutely nutty. We're not stuck here. We are not stuck. We are not stuck in this confusion at all. Not at all. Spirit and mind can realize, can recognize, especially spirit. Spirit can recognize what's going on here, choose a new idea, and have the whole situation resolved, and have a great relief from that. But all this frantic mudslinging and, you know, that's going on, and it's just, it's like going to the zoo, you know, and watching something. The animals in the zoo just acting, you know, it's like, whoa, come on. We can do a lot better than that. There is no perspective. But here, there's perspective. This is why I make the videos. There's a new, fresh, clear perspective. And we are not caught. We are not caught at all. I'm not caught in that. Spirit doesn't have to be caught in that. Mind doesn't have to keep acting crazy, because spirit can change the idea that it tells mind to present. If spirit chooses an insane idea, mind appears to act insane. But spirit has to say, wait a minute. That must be because I chose an insane idea that mind is this way, right? And then the resolution is there. Instead of trying to get mind to act sanely when spirit chooses an insane idea, instead spirit says, wait a minute. It's up to me to choose a new idea, a sane idea, and then mind will act sanely. But to try and keep an insane idea and then try to get mind to act sanely, that's why you have all this gibberish that's on the comment sections and the articles and Yahoo and everywhere else. You have a lot of Yahoos commenting. It's just gibberish. And pretty sad, pretty pathetic. But that's what happens when there's a basic lack of understanding that it's spirit that has to choose a new idea. And that it's spirit that chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, which is an insane idea. And therefore mind has to present that in an insane way, a very crazy way. And that's what it's doing. That's what mind is doing. Mind is simply doing what it must do to present this idea. There's no blame in mind whatsoever. It is futile to blame mind, to criticize mind. Absolutely futile. That is not the way. Mind is actually functioning perfectly. It's doing exactly what it needs to do to present this idea. Absolutely perfect. Thank you, mind, for always being perfect. This is the attitude you should have, that spirit should have. When spirit thanks mind, just then there's a feeling of in the heart, almost like gratitude, and there's a realization, I'm not really stuck at all. You see, spirit thinks that mind has gone crazy. It has not. It's the idea that spirit chose that's crazy. Mind is just presenting symbolically a crazy scenario, and to make the spirit think that mind has gone crazy. So I tell you this, the situation we are in is that mind is trying to convince spirit that spirit has gone crazy. In fact, that spirit is going to be that mind is going to be annihilated. Mind is trying to convince spirit that mind is going to be annihilated, and it's gradually moving towards that direction. And so spirit thinks that mind has gone crazy or something. Not true. Not true, but that's what mind is trying to convince spirit of. So when people are saying, oh, mind is bad, mind is terrible, they're being fooled by mind. They're being conned by mind, which is what we ask mind to do. We basically asking mind to completely fool us about itself. Mind is telling us that it's going to be annihilated. And it's getting us used to that. It's getting us ready, prepared for that fact that mind is going to disappear no more. Which is complete folly. But that is literally what is required when spirit chooses the idea of wanting to be prime creator. It ends up by mind trying to prepare spirit for the complete annihilation of mind. Alright, so the mind is trying to prepare us for that, and that's why it all seems so crazy. The whole existence seems so bizarre. It is bizarre. Gradually, mind is trying to prepare us for the annihilation of mind. And spirit's all scared, says, oh my gosh, I gotta learn these lessons, you know. And then think, well, maybe mind, if I heal you, you won't, you know, that kind of thing. No, see it as it is and say, oh, mind, you're doing an absolutely flawless job of this. Totally great. You're presenting the idea perfectly to me, the only way you can. And I completely can trust you now that you're not harmed or sick or anything. You're not going to be annihilated. It's the idea that I chose, and I can choose a new idea this very instant like that. No problem whatsoever. So it's very important to feel on good terms with mind again. And spirit can do that by just having a feeling of gratitude and say, thank you, mind. Thank you for doing exactly what you had to do. I'm so relieved. Even though, don't try to heal mind. Mind isn't sick. See, it's not mind that's sick. People keep thinking the mind is sick and it needs to be healed. No. Mind is completely well. It's impossible to be sick. It is presenting the idea that we gave it to present to us. That's how reality works. Perfectly. It's doing it perfectly. So just say, thank you, mind, for being perfect. That's a great declaration. Thank you, mind, for always being perfect. And then feeling that, thank you, mind, for always being perfect. And this is such a powerful, powerful declaration. Thank you, mind, for always being perfect. It reverberates. This is a kind of reverberating declaration. That it's deeper than being asking for, petitioning for. Can I have a little more money? Can I have a little more of this? Say, thank you, mind, for always being perfect. Always being completely flawless, functioning perfectly. Thank you so much, mind. You know, mind says, huh? Oh, that's great. It catches mind's ear, says, wow. You get it. Good. Mind's so happy that it hasn't fooled you forever. You know, mind doesn't want to fool you forever, but it has no choice. If you don't choose a new idea, what can mind do? Mind is not a free agent. It can't decide what ideas it's going to present. It's spirit that chooses the ideas and then gives them, and mind presents the ideas. Reflects like a reflection of the idea that spirit has, and spirit experiences the idea in all sorts of rich ways. So mind is so happy when you praise mind and say, mind, you're perfect. Mind, you are perfect. You've always been perfect. You always will be perfect. Mind, you are absolutely perfect. Instead of petitioning mind for something, just tell mind that it's perfect. And tell yourself that. You're telling yourself that, actually. So don't waste time on petitions. That's spinning your wheels. Sure, when you spin your wheels, you hear the car revving and the wheels are turning, and it seems like something's happening, but it's not really what's effective. Thank you, mind, for being absolutely perfect in all ways. So this is like our own Pentecost. We said we thank the mind for always being perfect. And this is the truth. This is a statement of truth. The mind has always been perfect. It has never gone anywhere. Oh, I used to tear my hair out when I hear that some gurus and sages and stuff say, you know, attack the mind and say, the mind is very bad. We must conquer the mind. We must overcome the mind, blah, 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 blah. I said, no. That's a lack of understanding. Lack of understanding. Not all gurus understand the whole situation at all. Just like they're following a lineage, and this is what the lineage has taught. But they grasp what the lineage has taught, but it may have been distorted at times, etc. It's not, they don't necessarily have it right. If anyone talks about how wicked the mind is, they're wrong. They're mistaken about that. Mind is utterly free of any wickedness whatsoever. mind is flawless, it's perfect, it's loving, there's no fault whatsoever with the mind. That's a fact. It's the idea that we gave the mind to present to us, it was a whim, crazy whim, of wanting to be prime creator, of displacing the prime creator. And mind has no choice but to actually then try to prepare us for its own annihilation. Symbolically, of course, it has to conjure up this whole realm of impermanence and tell you that it's all God. God did all this. God conjured all this up. It's all good, and that we're stuck here, and this is all we have. It has to do that. It has to do that. It has to try and fool us. But when mind hears that you're not fooled, it's so happy. You know, it's so happy to hear that. It's kind of like, whew, big relief for the mind. I mean, this idea is not fun for anyone, is it? It's nightmare. It's not fun for anyone. So, yeah, mind is happy to hear those words. Happy to hear those words. So much disrepute has been piled on mind. All of it totally mistaken. Lack of understanding, lack of context. And once we trust the mind again, then we'll choose a new idea, and we'll trust the mind to present that accurately too. Mind is just presenting this idea accurately the only way it can present it to us. In a crazy way. In a madcap, farcical way. Existence is a farce. Absolute farce. It is really a farce. And of course, mind tells us that it's all under control and all perfect and all exactly. No, it's a farce. It's an absolute farce. And it has to be. It has to be. Because we're trying to prepare for the annihilation of mind. And how do we do that? We're all frantically scatter all over the place thinking, oh my god, how are we going to do this, and we can't. So again, it is a madcap farce beyond description, but that's all what is necessary to present this whimsical, eccentric idea of spirit changing reality, changing its role in reality. That's why we can just simply say, oh, I accept my role in reality. No more farce. Bliss at that point. Bliss. No more farce. We no longer need to try to explain to ourselves what reality is. We experience it directly. And what a farce that is, trying to explain what reality is, explain what we are. I mean, that's incredible farce, isn't it? So even though we have all these yahoos commenting nonstop and throwing out their two cents and all this, you know, gibberish, really, that doesn't mean that we're stuck. Even though everybody pretends to be stuck, that's only the mind. That's just the play of mind. That's the play of mind. Beyond that, there's an observation of all this. That's the spirit. The spirit is observing this, saying, what's going on here? You know, it's like, huh. How's this preparation going along? You know, I see all this stuff. What is this? And that awareness is greater than the ordinary play of awareness that we think of as awareness. The play of awareness that we think of as awareness is just the play of mind, actually. But there's also the awareness of spirit saying, what's going on here? Is this really necessary? Can I choose a new idea? Am I really stuck? So that's a different kind of intelligence. It's called true reason, as opposed to the fake reason, the intelligence, that the play of mind that we call intelligence. It's fake intelligence, fake reason. That's why they say faith is greater. What faith means is faith in the higher reason, the reason of spirit, the clarity of spirit. Faith in the Holy Spirit means faith in higher reason, rather, and don't believe this fake reason that the play of mind is presenting to us. But it's pretty instructive viewing those comments, because you see how people are thinking in the world. You can just see it's obvious, and you realize how they're struggling so badly. You know, they're simply caught up in the play of mind, this crazy play of mind. They're caught up in it thinking that that is intelligence or reason. It is not. It's bogus. It's completely bogus. The Holy Spirit is necessary for real perspective. The Holy Spirit tells you, hey, the perspective that mind is giving to you is deceptive. It's self-deceptive. And the Holy Spirit says, listen to my perspective. I'll show you real perspective. And then gradually you start gaining this perspective and you say, wow, all this play of mind is just deception. It's all only deception. And then you see, but it's the only way that mind can present this idea. It has to do that. It's not mind's fault. But it is deceptive. It's deception. Absolutely. You get people calling each other brain dead morons and stuff like that. Yeah. Well, what do you do to a brain dead quote unquote moron? You know, pull the plug, right? They call it a vegetable. No brain function. So when people start calling each other that and mean it, that means you know what their agenda is. Their agenda is to pull the plug on you. It absolutely is. And again, that's mind, and it's crazy. This crazy game, play of mind. Getting you people ready for the annihilation of mind. Mind says, hey, guess what, Spirit? I'm going to be leaving you. One day I won't be here. I'll be completely annihilated. And I'll be no more. So you better get ready for that. So let's keep working on it. And Spirit says, okay, I better keep paying attention to what mind is trying to teach me. And yeah, all the while, Spirit remains the same. Spirit's not changing at all. But it thinks it needs to pay attention to this. It's some important lesson that it needs to learn. It's not true. So today's Pentecost, and that is the pouring out of the wisdom of the Holy Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit upon the those assembled at that time. And but we have our own Pentecost, which is the pouring out of clarity upon the world, pouring out clarity for those who are prepared to see it. And the clarity is certainly here. It's certainly here. I'm experiencing it myself, enjoying it. But if you go back to the comment section, Yahoo comment section, you don't see it there. You don't see any clarity there. You know, you can easily think, oh my gosh, we're all crazy. You know, we're all stupid. You see so much stupidity, you start thinking, oh my gosh, maybe stupidity is right. If everybody's doing it, it must be right, huh? That's the false reasoning of the mind, of this play of mind. It's just a play of mind. It's not mind, it's the play of mind presenting this crazy idea of trying to change reality and be prime creator. Trying to get us ready for mind's annihilation so we won't have anything to present ideas to us at all. We will be completely helpless and unable to experience it all, and we will feel like nothing. And then we'll have to try and explain to ourselves what it is that we want to be experiencing instead of experiencing it. In other words, just symbolic, conceptual explanations. We'll have to settle for that. That's how this play is supposed to end up. But of course, Spirit cannot function without mind, and Spirit cannot get rid of mind at all, cannot change reality at all. So this is all just a game. A play that gets nowhere and serves no purpose at all, actually. Mind will never be annihilated. Don't worry. It's only a game, a bluff. Mind is just bluffing. Don't be fooled by the bluff. It has to bluff this way. But when you come into this world, you get the feeling that mind has gone crazy. And more so, when you read all the spiritual teachings in the world, you get the sense that mind also is terrible. We must free ourselves from mind. Could anything be worse? Talk about folly. Freeing ourselves from mind would mean the mind is annihilated. That's the very thing that we're trying to realize is false. We don't want to free ourselves from the mind. We want to realize that there's no possibility of that. And therefore, we don't need to prepare for it, right? If something can never happen, why do we need to prepare for it, is the question. Obviously we don't. What a beautiful day here, unbelievable. 84 degrees, sparkling clear, and a soft, cool breeze. It's just like, If only it... Take a little break here. We're hitting it hard here on Pentecost, May 19th, which, interesting enough, is the 4444, the 4-4s day. So it's a very important Pentecost today. The 4-4s, 44th president, 4 years, 4 months in office. Fourth dimensional takeover. And yet, fourth dimensional takeover, what does that mean? It means that they think, oh, we know how to heal the mind. We can heal the mind. The mind is very, very sick, but we can heal it. That's the ultimate in folly. Mind isn't sick. Nothing that God created is sick. Nothing, and there's nothing else that exists. Mind is not sick. It doesn't need to be healed at all. Not at all. What we have to do is choose a new idea so mind can present that idea. But as far as healing the mind, that is a complete lunacy. What fourth dimension is really saying is that they can get better explanations, and so they'll figure out a way to be without the mind. They can figure out a way. You know, science will have the answer. They tell us science will have the answer. Have the explanation. Have the figures. Have the calculation. How do we function without the mind? The fourth dimension is said, we'll figure that one out. We can measure everything. We should be able to figure that one out. Oh my gosh. Someday they'll have a good laugh over that. But we can laugh now. We don't have to delay our laughter. That's something that Jesus said, you know. Jesus said, you know, all the only thing that really happened is you forgot to laugh at how silly the idea was. You forgot to laugh. It's just, and so we don't have to wait to laugh. We can laugh right now. It's so silly. The whole thing's so silly. And it's important to laugh at it, because Jesus says, yeah, the final step is you'll just laugh at it. And it just, it's funny. And the whole thing is laughed away, and that's it. It is silly. We're trying to heal the mind. We're trying to fix the mind. That is hilarious. Mind is not sick. It's not sick at all. The idea is a sick idea. But how do you heal a sick idea? By choosing another one. You don't heal an idea. You choose another one. And this is something that needs to, if you don't laugh at the absurdity of trying to heal an idea that is so absurd, you choose another one. If you don't like this idea, choose another idea. If you don't like the way the idea of wanting to be prime creator plays out, choose the idea of not wanting to be prime creator. Very simple. The idea is not, the ideas aren't sick. It can't be sick. Mind can't be sick. There's nothing that can be sick, actually. It's impossible. When we get sick, like cancer and all this stuff, it's just our attempt to explain what we are. It's our attempt to explain what we are, and which is really our attempt to prepare to be without mind. For mind to be annihilated. All sickness is just that. It's just our preparations. We're preparing. We're just preparing. That's the root of all sickness, all suffering. Is again, the mind is trying to prepare us for its annihilation. So the mind presents these sicknesses. Isn't it? We're not sick. The mind is presenting the sickness. And it's not a real sickness at all. It's just a way, symbolic lessons to try and prepare us for the ultimate sickness, of which means the death of mind. Mind is trying to prepare us for the death of mind, which will never happen. So of course all these bodies come and go and die, etc. And that's just, again, the play of mind, trying to prepare us for the ultimate death of mind, and therefore the essential annihilation of spirit. There's, you know, complete non-functionality of spirit. Never happened. There's no possibility of happening whatsoever. It's all just hypothetical. So we're pouring out clarity here on Pentecost, on the 4-4s day. Getting the ball rolling here. But it's just showing that we have momentum. We have the momentum. Momentum is on our side. Momentum is on the side of truth. It always is. But as soon as you identify with mind's farce, then you don't see it that way. It's just a complete absurd farce. Mind is preparing us for its death. We think, oh, thank you, mind, you're so nice. How thoughtful of you. How thoughtful. You're preparing us for your death. You're going to die and leave us someday, but you're giving us this great, great, great preparation. we get to experience dying over and over and over, and the death of everybody. We get to experience all this death here. Oh, this is so wonderful. Mind you, made a universe full of death to prepare us for your death, and that is so thoughtful of you. That's how we feel. We think, oh. And we worship mind as God, saying, God, just thank you for preparing us for your death, you know. But it's really just mind. And it's of course, it won't die. Mind cannot die. So it's all just a farce, a waste of time. But that is what mind is doing. It made all, imagined all this up, and now is using all this to give us these lessons, preparing us for its death. A little bit at a time, a little bit of time. Oh, my friend died. Oh, this died. Oh, this died. Oh, my garden has now died. These flowers, the trees, the people, all the civilization has now collapsed and died. Oh, this has died, died, died. And mind is saying, you see, you need to get used to all this stuff, because eventually mind itself will die. And then what are you going to do if you're not ready? Oh, then you'll really feel like nothing. Of course, you could never get ready for the mind dying. That's impossible. It's all just a farce, a complete farce. And the more you see through it, the funnier it is. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. That's a very powerful declaration. If you're able to see that and feel it, then you know you are, you're there. You are very close indeed to happiness. To freedom from this fear, to freedom from death, from freedom all this farce, this nonsensical farce. Crazy, crazy, crazy play of mind. If you can say thank you, mind, for being perfect, and feel it, not just the intellectual thing, but actually feel it, like, because it's coming from your heart, there, coming from your spirit. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. And imagining this vast scenario of loss and sacrifice and suffering and death to prepare me for your death, because I wanted to be prime creator, which means I wanted to change reality, which means the annihilation of reality, because reality is all one indivisible whole. There's no parts to change in it. If any of it changes, none of it is anymore, so to speak. So mind presented this, had to present it somehow as an experience. So it has to be an experiencer. So mind cannot annihilate spirit. It has to annihilate itself, actually. At least pretend to annihilate itself. And then it showed that to spirit. It symbolized its own annihilation through total chaos, mental chaos. And spirit said, oh, no, I can't handle that. And then mind says, yeah, but I have something better for you. I got all this total universe here. You can gradually learn to accept the death of mind through all this sojourns in this cosmos and all the dimensions and all of form and energy-based existence, as it were, which is all symbolic. It's all imaginary. It's all hypothetical. Reality is based on essence, direct experiencing. It's idea. It's not based on energy at all. So, thank you, mind, for being perfect. That is a powerful, powerful declaration. Because it just stuns everything, doesn't it? I mean, it just stops everything. Talk about a full stop. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. That just puts everything, the brakes on everything, doesn't it? Even all your spiritual thinking that you've heard from other places and stuff, it says, boom, stop, wait a minute, what do you mean? I thought we were supposed to heal mind. I thought we were supposed to discipline mind. Put mind in its place. I like to do all that. No, you don't have to do anything to mind. Mind is perfect. It's already in its place. It's perfectly in its place. Thank you, mind, for always being perfectly in your place. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. That puts a full stop. That's a reverberator. You know you have a declaration when you have a reverberator where you feel like this full stop in your being. It's like, whoa, like that, whoa, it's just something, it's just everything is like, the brakes have, you know, been put on. So, when a declaration occurs to you, you can test it out to see if it has this full stop quality to it, this wow quality. And this one really does. Thank you, mind, for always being in your place, in the right place. Thank you, mind. You've always been in the right place. You always will be. And you're absolutely perfect. That's hitting home. That is hitting home really big time. Because this is stating the truth. That truth that has rarely been stated. Set you on a stable foundation right there. It's like you're feeling that you're on a stable foundation now, and you're saying, whoa, what's this? I feel stability. What is that? Because I'm not used to feeling stability. So stability feels like, huh? What is this? And there's the stability of truth. The mind has always been perfectly in its place. Mind has always functioned perfectly. Thank you, mind, for always being in your place, for always functioning perfectly. Thank you for being perfect, always. Thank you for really being exactly, always exactly what I need you to be. You've never deviated at all, mind. You've never even deviated the slightest bit. Thank you for that. And thank you, I see it. This is a powerful, powerful reverberator. Continues to reverberate throughout my nervous system. It's like cleaning house. Rarely does mind get this correct praise. It's just simply stating the truth. And it's really spirit that needs to hear this. Thank you, mind, for always being perfect. And we're not trying to cajole mind into changing. No, 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 no. Thank you, mind, for you. I now know you've always been perfect. I now know you've never deviated one bit from your perfect functioning for me. You've always been there for me. Thank you, mind. You've always been there for me perfectly. And this has been said in the ultimate sense that even when mind, of course, the whole time mind has been pretending to not be here for us perfectly, it's always been there for us perfectly. Of course, because we ultimately requested its annihilation. And so it's trying to prepare us for that. Even though that can never happen, mind has to play along and present this idea to us. So it's trying to prepare us for that. This feeling's close to bliss. There's a feeling kind of like bliss is almost coming into the picture, actually. Because once we see the situation like this, then what else is there except bliss? We don't need to fight, struggle anymore. What are we struggling with? Mind is perfect. We can just abide in this realization that mind is perfect. That brings the bliss of relief. It brings bliss. Mind is perfect just as it is. We don't need to change mind the slightest bit. We don't need to struggle with mind. We don't need to heal mind. We don't need to fix it. We don't need to change it. We don't need to put it in its right place. It's never left its right place. It's never been broken. It's never been sick. It's never been wrong. It's doing exactly, always done exactly what it needs to do. Functioning perfectly. So, this is what I see as you know, fifth dimensional teaching, of real teaching, or sharing clarifications, putting things in the right perspective. Complete turnaround. And you may be wondering, how do we shed all this teachings of this world, all these spiritual teachings that we know are just kind of not quite, you know, how do we shed those? Well, this is it. Thank the mind for being perfect. I know there are those who say, well, the mind has tried to take us over and it be the master and we be the servant, and that's wrong, and we need to tell mind to get in its right place, and or we need to slay the mind. The mind is causing loss. No. None of those teachings are truly effective. What spirit needs to tell itself is that all is well with reality, and all has always been well. Mind is perfect, perfect servant. Always has been, always will be. No concern, no worries whatsoever, without having to do anything. I don't need to do anything. The mind has always been perfect. That's another one. The mind, thank you, mind, for always being perfect. I don't need to do anything for you to always be perfect. I don't need to do anything in concern with mind. I'm not concerned with mind. Mind is perfect. I don't need to do anything. So you rest in bliss, and people say, how come you're not fixing the mind? I mean, how don't you help us heal the mind? If someone's sitting in bliss, the spiritual people of the world will come and say, wow, you're so happy, you're such bliss, that's great. Now, come on, help us heal the mind. I mean, there's still so much mind that is sick. Maybe you healed a little part of mind, but the rest of the mind is really crazy and sick. We need to go fix it and heal it. Come on, help us out. And you just say, no, the mind is flawless, perfect. There's no such thing as a part of the mind. That's the play of mind, that's deceiving the self, as it must do with this idea. There's no such thing as a part of the mind. Mind will never die. You can't have a part of the mind die. You can't have a part of reality be annihilated. But of course, when spirit asks for this, it's asking for an experience. And so mind's job is to present an experience to spirit. So it presents this experience of the mind being annihilated, saying, this is what's going to happen, spirit. I'm going to disappear forever from you. And spirit says, no. I can't handle that. I can't handle that. And mind says, oh, don't worry, you'll be able to. I'll just have to prepare you for it. And boom, here's all this time. Here's billions of years to get ready for it. So when we get to this proper addressment of time, of mind, addressment of mind, then that is, we are opening the door to bliss, actually. Because how often has any gotten to this spot of being able to do this? It's funny, people keep saying, well, I don't know. And say, I can't be that, or whatever. But how do we know we haven't, how often do we get to this spot where we actually do it? People assume, well, that can't be it or something, but it is it. It's just that very few get to the spot where they actually declare this. People, very few are willing to do that. They think mind is the problem. It's not the problem. Mind is never the problem. There's another one. Again, mind is never the problem. That's a powerful one. Mind is never the problem. Thank you, mind. Mind is never the problem. It's not like we're using the mind incorrectly. We don't have to learn how to use the mind correctly. We're not misusing the mind. The mind is functioning perfectly. There's no such thing as misuse of mind. That's impossible. Oh, that's the play of mind is telling us it's the misuse of mind is possible. But that's a lie. That's a deception. Misuse of mind is not possible. Mind is being used perfectly right now. So we don't need to learn how to use the mind. We need to choose a new idea so the mind can present that to us. No, that's nonsense. Mind is not unruly. Mind is not out of control. Mind doesn't need to be taught anything. Mind is not being misused. We are not ignorant of how to use the mind. None of that stuff. That's just the play of mind to try to get us ready for its annihilation. But we, spirit, know. We know better. We know better. We don't have to teach the mind anything. God created the mind. Why do we need spirit to teach the mind how to function? We need to teach the mind how to function? Did God create the mind unruly? No. Do we need to calm the mind down? No. We don't need to do anything with the mind except choose a new idea. Give the mind another idea to present to us. And whenever one is, the feeling now is like, well, we better get back to work and work to get the mind right. No, we never have to get back to work to get the mind right. The world will listen to what is said and say, I get it. Okay, yeah, that's great. Okay, let's get back to work now. Let's get back to work. Get the mind right. We say, the mind doesn't need to be made right. It's always right. It's perfect. And I'll say, yeah, okay, I get it. Now let's go back to work. We need to make it right. Because, you know, most go to, for instance, a great guru, and they go there as motivation to help them get the mind right, help them subdue the mind. And so they go there, and that's the only purpose they go there for. So they simply assume that whatever happens is for motivation for them to do that. And then they leave, and they say, okay, now I got some motivation to subdue the mind. And even if the guru says, you don't need to subdue the mind, the mind is perfect, it's just praise the mind and thank the mind, they'll think, that's good motivation to subdue the mind now. I need to subdue the mind. That's what happens. So very few actually listen to what's being said and say, don't need to subdue the mind. The mind is perfect. Wow. That's a different perspective. And then, you know, consider that and say, interesting. Let me work this through. Let me contemplate this. Silently repeat it. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. That puts a full stop on insanity right there. All insanity, full stop on it right there. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. Brings insanity to an end. It brings the whole farce to an end. It puts it all in the right context. You're no longer tilting at windmills. You're acknowledging, spirit's acknowledging it's spirit's responsibility to choose ideas, and it chose a foolish, crazy idea, just on a whim. And it's taking mind off the hook, because mind has never been on the hook. But spirit needs to acknowledge that, hey, I know you've never been on the hook. You had me going there, mind. You really had me tricked and fooled, but now I know. Now I see. In my mind, you've always been perfect. This is like a great declaration, I'm telling you. I'm feeling this. I'm feeling it powerfully. That's like the very definition of a prayer, if you want to define it. Somebody's just powerful. You can feel it. Mine, you've always been perfect. This has a resonance, an inner resonance. Resonance that seems to go deeper and deeper and resonating more and more and more and more and more. Like a breath of fresh air. After a long, long, hot, weary, terrible trail, dusty trail, you finally come to a place of shade and cool water, and you feel, it's relief, finally relief. Mind, you've always been perfect. Just tell your mind that, mind, you've always been perfect. This has to be the most profound declaration I have come up with, has come to me. Mind, you've always been perfect. Mind, I know that you've always been perfect. Well, it keeps on. It continues. It continues. It's still powerful. Powerful. There's a feeling like that's all that needs to be said. That's all that needs to be said. What can prevail against that? This statement is, it like, has it all. It's kind of like ironing out all the wrinkles. It just irons out the wrinkles, which is what we need right now. A lot of wrinkles in the world right now. Mind, you've always been perfect. Whew, man, that's a powerful, very, very effective. Full stop effectiveness. You talk about this, this is like capable of ironing out the wrinkles and lifting us up. Helping enable us to bypass the continued dance of mind, the play of mind, but this idea of existence. We don't need to continue on with that self-deception, all that. No, we say, mind, you've always been perfect. And you always will be perfect, and you can never leave me. I know that now. So why do we need the charade anymore? Don't need the charade anymore. Don't need death anymore. Don't need impermanence. Don't need loss. Don't need isolation. Don't need suffering. Don't need any of that anymore. Mind, you've always been perfect. Mind, you're perfect. I don't need to even consider it otherwise anymore, because I see the deception. I see what you did. I see what happened. I'm no longer deceived. No longer deceived. So, mind, you've always been perfect. To say this is hitting me harder than anything else I've ever said. I've said this before, but not with so much conviction. But this is more conviction. I'm saying with more conviction because I understand it now clearly. What mind has had to do is trying to prepare us for its own annihilation. That's what mind has been trying to do. And so it seems like a brutal taskmaster, brutal nightmare, and we hate mind. Mind, why are you giving us this horrible, terrible stuff, you know? And we've been blaming mind all along. And now we're lifting the blame off of mind, saying, mind, you're blameless and all this. You're totally blameless. So So it's a steep climb to get to that point where you say, mind, you're totally blameless, which is a whole 180 degree turnaround from blaming mind, saying, mind, you're crushing us, you're horrible, you're torturing us and all this stuff. Again, mind is only giving us the illusion of preparation for its own annihilation, which we're demanding of it. And this is the play that mind must present. A ghastly, terrible, frightening nightmare of a play. It's not mind's fault at all. Mind is blameless in all this. So resting in the blamelessness of mind, spirit can feel, ah, I'm safe, I'm safe, I'm safe. Nothing is wrong. There's no danger whatsoever. I'm free of all danger. I thought there was a danger. Mind could be annihilated. They can't. There isn't. I'm no longer deceived. Spirit resting in this would be bliss, very peaceful bliss. We're not trying to punish spirit, but mind. We're not saying, mind, you've been very bad. We have to punish you. No, it has not been bad at all. It's been perfect. So when we talk about like a realization, this is a realization that mind has always been perfect. It's never been wrong, it's never been bad, it's never been out of place, it's always been done exactly what needed to be done. Mind is perfect. This is a realization. It's a game changer for us. Game changer. How could it not be? You go from blaming the mind to seeing the mind is blameless. That is a game changer. Something that fundamental is a true game changer. Well, thank you, Holy Spirit, for bringing us this on Pentecost, May 19th, the Four Fours Day, the worst of days, the best of days. As always, you came through just at the right moment of showing us this. Mind is perfect. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. Thank you, mind, for being so perfect. Again, thank you, mind, for being so perfect. It's a game changer because of your acknowledging that mind has been presenting a nightmare, of course. But that's what it's functioning, call for, perfect, flawlessly. So instead of attacking mind and saying, mind, I hate your nightmare. No. Do the opposite. Praise mind. Thank you, mind, for functioning absolutely perfectly. I'm so relieved to know that you're not crazy or demented, you're actually flawless, you see. That's a big step from trying to attack mind, isn't it? A very big step. It's a complete turnaround, 180-degree turnaround. That's what's required. That's what I tried to teach in this world from day one, and I met too much resistance. Because everybody here is all about, no, we need to attack the mind. We need to destroy the mind. We need to, you know, defeat the mind. We need to put the mind in its place. We need to slay the mind. We need to transcend the mind. All this stuff. And I said, no, that's all mistaken. You got 180 degrees wrong. It's very difficult to teach and make a 180 degree turnaround. Very difficult. That's the one thing that people say is impossible, can never happen, and it's ludicrous to even try. No, that they only want to make adjustments, but not a 180-degree turnaround. So it's extraordinarily difficult to get to this point. Because it's a 180-degree turnaround entirely. Mind is completely off the hook. Mind, you've always been off the hook. No pun intended. Your mind, you've always been perfect. Thank you, mind, for always being perfect. People will say, wow, can I really say that? am I going to lack preparation then? Mind's not going to prepare me, then suddenly it'll be annihilated and I won't have any preparation? No, again. This is all just self-deception. Mind cannot destroy itself, cannot be annihilated. It's only pretending that's possible for our sakes, so that we can have at least this entertain the idea of being prime creator, even though we never experience it. We're entertaining it. We're thinking like, hey, we're pretty cool. Or at least we're entertaining this idea. You know, wow, that's almost it, not quite. But so mind is giving us this entertaining of this idea of being prime creator by pretending that it is going to be annihilated and giving us all this tough love prep. That's why we say, oh God, God gives us suffering and stuff. And now it's mind that gives us, mind gives itself all this suffering. God doesn't give anyone any suffering. Doesn't give spirit any suffering. Mind is presenting this scenario of death and suffering as a way of preparation. A way of preparation for what can never happen. So thank you, mind, for being perfect. Just in time. We got this just in time. Those who want to chastise the mind are, you know, very much in vogue right now. And they're full of the vitriol of all that and the billy clubs. And they say, we're going to start busting heads and make whoever's mind isn't right, we're going to bust their heads, you know. And that too is a play of mind entirely. So we need to say, mind, thank you for always being perfect. Thank you for being perfect. Not as a way to try to heal mind. We're not saying that as an affirmation to try and restore mind to something. No, we're acknowledging mind doesn't need to be restored to anything. Mind, you've always been effortlessly perfect. I know that. I know you've always been perfect. I'm no longer deceived. Mind, I know you've always been effortlessly perfect. I'm no longer deceived. Just in time. Who knows what's going to happen in the world next, but it doesn't matter. You can be sure that mind, in its tough love preparation, is going to give something for sure. Absolutely, of course. That's what it has to do. But we don't have to suffer from that now at all. Not necessary. Seeing through the delusion and being able to thank mind and praise mind and accept mind as perfect. That frees us from the scenario. That is freedom. So even without the external guru, we've been able to get to this point. The inner guru is always there. The Holy Spirit is the inner guru. It's always there. The outer guru is just a marker, a milestone, something that can be useful. Apparently it's not always essential. The inner guru is sufficient. Because what does the inner guru have to do? Just get you to the point and say, thank you, mind, you've always been so perfect. Thank you, mind, for always being so perfect. And just get to that realization, simple realization. And the inner guru is absolutely capable of doing that. I don't have any external guru in the world. So, for me, that this is the teaching that I always wished I had in the world. So I'm kind of giving the teaching that I always wanted to have and couldn't get. I don't want the teachers telling me you need to fix the mind, or you need to overcome the mind, or any of this stuff. Well, they can say lesser mind, lower mind, or something. You know, that's a qualifier there. But even that is too dualistic, very dualistic. This is a non-dualistic perspective. Thank you, mind, you've always been perfect. There's no qualifiers. Higher mind, lower mind. No, it's just one mind. There's no higher or lower in mind at all. It's just one mind. So I see everyone struggling with the mind and saying, I got to make it better. That is the mind. That is the struggle. That is what mind, that's the play of mind. That's fooling everyone. Just thank mind, spirit thanking mind, saying, mind, I see it. You've always done exactly what needed to be done, and all this isn't perfect. You're perfect. You're perfect. And then spirit breathes a sigh of relief, says, mind is perfect. I can choose a new idea, and I'm going to get a perfect presentation of that idea. That's the healing. That spirit gets the confidence in mind, saying, I can choose a new idea. Otherwise, spirit won't choose a new idea. What an unbelievable day. Liquid sunshine. Ridiculous. But here we are, doing this taping is more important than being out in the liquid sunshine, of course. Just imagine if I'd gone play golf today, you know. What an opportunity missed. There's something, you know. We're not giving mind any qualifiers. Like, we're not saying, thank you, mind, for giving us such a nice day. No, we're saying, thank you, mind, for always being perfect, without exception, without any qualification, no qualification. There's an unconditional statement. Thank you, mind, for always being perfect, unconditional statement. This is an awakener. I can feel like there's something you call it, you know, an awakening. It's somehow waking from the dream, as it were. It's like my nervous system is being loosened from the delusion, from the dream, from the delusion. And when you say this, say it with conviction, what happens? You experience the mind as perfect. And so you're in bliss. You say, everything's perfect. My gosh, nothing is wrong. There's nothing wrong anywhere. There's nothing wrong. There's never been anything wrong. So we need this game changer now. Because again, mind is going to present a wacky, farcical, tough love situation of preparation for its own annihilation, right? So, hold on to your hats, buckle up for that one. But again, we can awaken from this, realize that everything's always been perfect. Nothing is wrong. It's impossible that anything ever be wrong. Nothing is out of place. And then see what happens, see what comes from that. I don't know. Have to find out. Yeah, this is a reverberator. Just this is reverberate, reverberate, reverberate. Can still breathe. Can still drink water. Not a problem. Temptation here in California is to get out and recreate. I mean, just if we were here, you couldn't believe the day. It is so nice. But again, you have to have a wisdom and say, wait a minute, the world is not nice. This dream, this farce of minds presenting to us is tough love and tough preparation. And you can bet your bottom dollar that the tough times are coming. Toughness is coming. In one way or another, tough love is coming, as it were. The version of tough love, of preparing for mind's annihilation, that preparation is going to continue very strongly. So forget about the nice weather. That's here today, gone tomorrow. As a matter of fact, it will be gone tomorrow. First tomato, cherry tomatoes turning red today. It's already turning, and it's going to be edible in, I don't know, maybe a week or so. Everything so far had been green, and Suddenly, it turned red. Boom. Incredible. May 19th, tomatoes are turning red. So don't be afraid of this tough love that's coming. You have the declaration that frees you from it. If you can actually say this, thank you, mind, for being perfect, you guaranteed you are on the cusp of bliss. Because there's not many in the world who can say that. They will ask themselves, like, huh, should I say that? Like, they'll say, thank you, mind, for always being perfect, huh? They're considering it. They say, I wonder if I can say that. Doesn't seem right. Can I say that? I don't know, I gotta fix the mind. How can I say mind? Mind is terrible, give me this terrible nightmare. How can I thank mind? They'll consider it, but they won't say it. It's a whole different thing to say it. I know many times I've gotten spiritual advice and I consider it, but I don't actually say it. And so, who will actually say it and feel it and let themselves feel it? It's a powerful thing. But for those who do, I'm telling you, you're going to be in bliss. And the tough love of mind's farce is not going to bother you. Not going to bother you. Won't be affected by it. So again, it's up to each and every one to apply it to themselves. Nobody can lead a horse to water. But you can give a declaration, but you can't make the horse drink. You can't force people to say it, because they always will. They can say it like as a consideration, like, should I say this? Like, they'll say, thank you, mind, for being perfect. And their mind is saying, should I say this or not? I'm not sure. I'm just kind of considering whether or not I should say it. You know, so they don't really say it. You cannot force anybody to say it. Pretty interesting. David Beckham, the great footballer, announced his retirement yesterday and had sort of a ceremony retiring. Just before May 19th. Interesting. He said, that's it. He said, I always know when it's time. He says, it's time to call it quits on that one. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. To actually say it, not just to consider saying it. Because most people say, whoa, I don't want to let mind off the hook. The people say, I've worked all my life to pin mind down and get rid of it. And now I'm saying, thank you, mind, for being perfect. Mind will be re-energized, you know. That'll re-energize mind, and mind will say, oh, so you really do like me, and I guess I'm not going to quit. So they'd be afraid to say it. People say, no, I don't want to tell mind that it's perfect because it's been torturing me forever, you know. It's not really torturing us, it's torturing itself. It's giving a picture of torture. But spirit is not really torturing spirit. It's torturing these bodies and all these symbols. And the suffering that spirit thinks it's experiencing really comes from spirit buying into the whole premise that mind is going to be annihilated. And so spirit feels it needs to feel all this stuff. But spirit really doesn't need to feel suffering or pain or anything at all. That's what the great teachers tell us, that to them, suffering of the body, it's nothing. It's nothing. Because they no longer accept the premise of it. They don't play along with the game. In other words, there's no, we're playing along with it, thinking that that there are lessons to be learned. So it's as if it really is real, even though it's not. Thank you, Spirit, for being perfect. No, thank you, Mind. Sorry. Thank you, Mind, for being perfect. The Spirit can thank itself, too, for being perfect. Nothing wrong with that. Thank you, Spirit, for being perfect. Thank you, Spirit, for being perfect. Thank you, Mind, for being perfect. And then, when you're thanking Mind for being perfect, you don't even care. All this stuff, you realize, you're off the hook, Mind. Completely off the hook. Why do I even need to interpret anything here? I don't need to. There's no need for any more interpretation. Mind's completely off the hook. Perfect day. In more ways than one, because Mind is always perfect. And that feeling of Mind is always perfect is always a perfect feeling. You see, that's what they call it, bliss. It's always a perfect feeling. And so at that point, it no longer matters what happens in this farce we call existence. It doesn't matter. The perfect feeling is always there. It's always the feeling, Mind, you're perfect. And I feel you're perfect. Which is the truth, the truth. That is natural feeling. The natural feeling of Spirit is the feeling of Mind is perfect. And so is Spirit, and so is all reality. But Mind is perfect. That's natural feeling. That's bliss. So we can have that feeling right now by accepting that Mind is perfect. And then everything else that happens, how can it affect that feeling at all? It doesn't affect it. We've accepted that Mind is perfect. And so it's dance of impermanence. It doesn't affect this feeling at all. Now you might say, how in the world could I possibly have gotten this, you know, straight, gotten it right? Thanks to my teachers, actually. Thanks to Jesus and then Anandamayi-Ma presenting this here in the world, showing us that that's exactly the attitude she had. Everything is perfect. She said, everything is perfect. It's always been perfect. But all these wars are happening. She says, it's all perfect. Everything is perfect. Don't worry about it. And so these teachers actually clued me into it. Otherwise, no go. It's too difficult. It's too difficult. Because we think that Mind is the enemy. We feel there's enemy somewhere. We got to find this enemy. There is no enemy. There is no enemy. That's another thing Anandamayi-Ma showed. She said, they said, all this fighting, you know, what's your take on this? She goes, what fighting? She says, no, they're just friends playing a silly game, farcical game. There are no enemies. There are no enemies. And again, there is no enemy. There is no enemy at all. None. Mind is perfect. Where is the enemy? This is just a play of mind. If mind is perfect, how can there be an enemy? Mind's not an enemy. Mind's not our enemy. Mind is perfect. But you really need to be clued into this in some way. Otherwise, you just... It's too difficult to even consider, really. I certainly struggled with it, but I said, no, I can tell that this guru is legit, that they really, this is true. They're telling us the truth. It's just I don't understand the basis of it. So it's my shortcoming, not theirs. And that's the key. You can find a guru you know that they know the truth, and you, it's your shortcoming, not theirs. You don't always feel that way, that is for sure. But at least the Potters of Time, you give the benefit of the doubt. It's they're telling the truth, and my belief, there's some enemy, that mind isn't perfect. That is my, I'm still caught in the delusion. I don't see what's going on, really. I don't really see it properly. Then you can make progress. Then you make progress. Because you check yourself, say, let me not waste time trying to fix the mind. I'm told that everything is perfect already, perfect. So let me give that benefit of the doubt. See, the dislike of all this, that too is the play of mind. All this dislike and hatred of this dream is also the play of mind. It's a symbolization. We don't really feel that way. Spirit isn't really experiencing all these different feelings, etc. It's just that Spirit is continuing to pay attention to it all and not choose a new idea because it thinks it's important. So it continues on. The nightmare continues on, and Spirit is just kind of transfixed by it. So mind, thank you for being perfect. I thank you, mind, for being perfect. Not good, not nice, but perfect. No wiggle room. Don't leave any wiggle room there. So mind, thank you for being perfect, for being flawlessly perfect. Thank you, mind, for being without a flaw. Thank you for being perfect. Thank you, mind, for being my perfect friend. Thank you, mind, for always being my perfect friend. That, again, sets the right context. Mind has been pretending to be a great enemy for the purpose of preparing us to be without it, to be without the mind. So thank you, mind, for being my perfect friend, for always being my perfect friend. I have a perfect friend. It is the mind. I have a perfect friend. It is the mind. I've always had a perfect friend. It's always been the mind. Thank you, mind, for being perfect, my perfect friend. Again, powerful reorientation here. Powerful turnaround. And all thanks to the great teachers for helping out with this. So we are not helpless. We are not hopeless. We are not trapped. We can always say these things. These things are easily said. I mean, from just a purely pragmatic standpoint of vocalizing, saying it to ourselves is easy. It's as easy as saying 1, 2, 3. Thank you, mind, for always being my perfect friend. I now see, mind, you've always been my perfect friend. So thank you, thank you, thank you. See, easy to say that. 1, 2, 3. ABC, 1, 2, 3. Not difficult. So we're not trapped. We can say that at any moment. Wherever we are, we can just say, ah, mind, I know you are perfect. Now I know, mind, that you are perfect. Now I know, mind, you've always been perfect. Now I fully accept with gratitude, mind, your perfection. I fully accept your protection, your perfection, mind. I fully accept your perfection. You can say at any time, in the midst of the most incredible farcical nightmare. Well, I'd like this video to go on forever, but I do have a recording limit on this camera of, 8 gigabytes. If I get a longer card, a bigger memory card, I could actually, maybe I'll do that. I'm thinking I get a 30, was it 36 or a megabyte card or something, and that would, or at least a 16, and that would enable a big file, a lot of files to upload, 20 minute files. Three, that would be 15 files, would take about 15 hours to upload, but it's possible. I can do that. I can do it. Running this camera off of electricity, so it's not a battery. Just I could literally keep recording 5 hours of this, and I may do that at some point. Actually, that's my. You know, we'll see. We'll see. Right now I have 8 gigabyte, and it gets chewed up fast. It's amazing how fast it gets chewed up. Like. 2 hours is 6 segments of 1.2 per segment. 6 times 1.2 is 7.2 gigabytes. So 2 hours, it basically fills up the card. Fills up the card. So 16 gigabytes will give me 4 hours. And 32 gigabytes would give me 8 hours of recording. Now, I can tell you that this feeling is not boring. It's not a boring feeling at all. It's like an amazing, wow. It's like a wow thing. It's not boring. Even though nothing is happening in my environment that's any different at all, it's happening within. It's happening within. Thank you, mind, for being perfect. And it's like, wow. This is an inner thing. So it's not stale at all. It's not stale. Of course, it might seem stale if you're not doing it and not feeling it, then you think, oh, that's it. I feel I need stuff happening. I need it. You know, put a video game on or something, and something has to be happening. But no, if you actually do it and feel it, you say, wow, this is better than anything that I could be doing in the world, actually. I'm feeling a fundamental shift. Like I'm being released from prison. Is that stale? If you have a feeling you're being released from a prison, you've been in a prison for billions of years, and you're being released from that jail, that jail cell. That's not a boring thing. That's like, wow. I'm being released from jail. That is the feeling. It's like that. Being released from jail. So that's a very interesting situation. And you can experience that most definitely. I'm just sharing it here so you can see that it's no problem. In whatever little bit that is going, but it's definitely impacting. Saying this is definitely impacting me, no question. It's not just an intellectual thing. I'm feeling it reverberating throughout my nervous system in even greater depths than that. It's reaching deep within my spirit, as it were. Deep feeling. More than even interacting with people, with your best friend, as it were, even deeper than that. So it's actually more enjoyable than spending time with your best friend. More enjoyable. Because you actually are spending time with your best friend. Which is mind. You are spending time with your best friend. Mind is our best friend. It's our perfect friend. It's that which has presented to us all our experiencing. And always will. All the incredible tapestry and richness of experiencing we've had in reality. Other than this nightmare of self-delusion, mind has been presenting all of that and will always be the presenter. So it is our perfect friend. We have perfect rapport with mind. We're one with mind. And yet its function is slightly different than spirit's function. So there's this rapport. So this feeling of reapproachment taking place is what the feeling is. There's this feeling of reapproachment taking place, rapport being reestablished, as it were, between spirit and mind. And that's very interesting, actually. Not in a way of all sorts of thoughts are coming. No, thoughts aren't really happening. It's deeper than that. So, reapproachment is kind of like you feel like, well, what's going to happen next? It's that kind of feel like, wow, this is great. What's going to happen next? It's like the ultimate movie. And I say, wow, I can't wait to see the next scene. This is incredible. So definitely, it's better than any movie. Way better than any movie. And it's like you say, it doesn't matter. What happens out there doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Because there's this reapproachment taking place. Which is not dependent on what's happening in time and space. In a dream. It's not dependent on what's happening in a dream. This perfect day continues on, as it were. The reapproachment continues, and practical matters come up in our day, for sure. Now, if we were in a cave somewhere, we could probably continue with this, but at some point you have to eat some rice, keep the fire going. So we'll keep the fire, cook some rice, and keep the fire going here. Keep cooking rice, keep the fire going, and keep allowing this reapproachment to take place. All right, that's it. We will do that. Very great.